Hey everybody, Adam from Passable Media here, and this is my quickie review for Spider-Man Far From Home. Non-spoilers first, this was always going to be a favourite for me. Marvel would have to have tried really, genuinely hard to make a bad movie for me not to like it. Spider-Man has always been my favourite Marvel hero, and my favourite hero full stop. I loved Raimi's Spider-Man trilogy, campy though it was, and I liked that Tobey Maguire, temporary emo phase notwithstanding, nailed Peter Parker as a character. I'm one of the apparent minority that loved Webb's amazing Spider-Man duology, and while Andrew Garfield's Peter Parker was janky at best, his Spider-Man was perfect. I guess what I'm saying is that between Maguire's Peter and Garfield's Spider-Man, we got as close as we're ever likely to get to the 90s cartoon's perfection of the character. With that said, Tom Holland blows both actors out of the park, in both roles. He's just so quintessentially Peter Parker and Spider-Man. He nails Peter's awkwardness and uncertainty and second-guessing of himself at every turn, and Spider-Man's chatty, taunty goading of his opponents that he uses to cover his awkwardness up. He's got a kind of energy that's just so MCU that it hurts. Granted, because of rights to characters and junk measuring contests between Sony and Disney, there is no chance that Marvel will risk building the MCU around him like they did with Robert Downey Jr.'s Iron Man. But they genuinely could. And I'm spending so long talking about the character because there's not a whole lot I can say about the film without running into a wall of spoilers. So I'll take a swing at it based on the trailers. The multiverse stuff that's mentioned in the trailers was one of the biggest draws to the film for me, and it didn't pay off in the way that I'd hoped. The elementals were ultimately underwhelming, and the expected twist, well, it was expected, and then it wasn't, and then wow. And the post-credit stuff sets up so much more than I ever expected coming into the film. It's just a legitimately solid film. Easily in my top four? I'm going to say top four MCU films overall. Probably top three in terms of solo movies, and second best in terms of sophomore outings. I cannot stress that it's a brilliant follow-on to Endgame, and not because it keeps the pressure on in the same end-of-the-world sort of way, but because it loops the issues back around to the personal and answers the seemingly inconsequential questions that some people wanted answering and some people didn't think about. But above all, it was satisfying in a way that many expected we couldn't get after Endgame set the bar so ridiculously high. And now I'm going to get into spoilers, and I cannot stress this enough. Click away now if you don't want to be spoiled, because I've got a ton to say and I'm not going to mess around with a fake spoiler preamble. I'm just jumping into it right now. Oh, John Watts, you magnificent bastard. I went into the cinema with decades of comic and cartoon foreknowledge that Quentin Beck was definitely going to be the big bad of this film, and I knew you'd try to trick me and that I wouldn't be convinced. I knew the trailers were a lie. I wasn't convinced when he was introduced. I wasn't convinced when he gave his sob story. I wasn't convinced when he took the name Mysterio as a sort of big up to Peter. I wasn't convinced when he gave Peter a pep talk. I wasn't convinced when he appeared to die. And then you absolutely convinced me at the last second when he had Edith on his face and Peter inducted him into the Avengers. Suddenly, I was Team Beck and looking forward to seeing how he helps the Avengers as we move on to phase four. Oh, and Beck's an evil maniacal nutcase who's super cool with mass murder, but more significantly, the murder of children. Wow, I'm hurt. And I feel stupid and used. Gyllenhaal was amazing as Beck, and I cannot stress enough that Spider-Man is always measured by his villains. It's why Homecoming is so beloved. The Vulture was an amazing first villain because he was so personal, and Beck cut so much deeper because for just a few minutes there, Peter saw him as a surrogate Tony, who was just a replacement for Uncle Ben, who was a replacement for his presumably own actual father. Jesus, is it any wonder that this kid has self-esteem issues going on when all of his father figures either die, betray him, or both? Beck's entire team, being people who have been wronged by Tony, does a good job of showing us that not everything about his legacy was good, and that there was still bound to be some fallout after Hurricane Stark has passed through. It was a work of genius to weave in Barth and William Reaver from Civil War and Iron Man respectively, and while a bunch of people thought that Barth would have had something to do with Mysterio's powers, I confess I wasn't one of them in the run-up to the film. Of course, the spiel about multiverses is bull, which is a shame, because the snap having opened holes between dimensions and releasing energy would have been a solid hook for future mutants, or for the Fantastic Four, or for alternate versions of characters we already know. But of course, Marvel knew all that when they wrote it in. They knew that comic book fans like me would jump up and down at the idea and pop our blinders on, even knowing that they routinely lie outright in their trailers to conceal plot details. Because even though it turned out to be an in-universe lie, it could just as well have been another trailer edit. The Elementals being illusions is a little bit of a shame too, because there was an opportunity for Hydro Man on the big screen, not to mention Sandman, Molten Man, and okay, I had to look this last one up, but Cyclone? More so, because since they actively mocked Hydro Man's origin story in the film itself, we're not likely to see a Morris Bench in the MCU. Although never say never. The relationships in this movie are spot on for the ages that they're portraying. The awkwardness in Peter and MJ's relationship is picture perfect, and I'm sure a good chunk of the audience remembers feeling how Peter felt, and whose heart skipped just a little when they missed catching each other looking at each other. Ned and Betty's is a bit more out there, but it does do a good job of showing the throwaway nature of high school relationships. How many people watching have been in one of those let's be boyfriend and girlfriend relationships that fizzled out within hours or days? Because everything back then was transient and didn't really matter. Even Happy and May's summer fling, with Happy thinking that it would continue, and May pretty steadfastly assuming that not only wouldn't it, but that she expected that he knew that from the start. Different expectations and all that. On the subject of relationships, the fallout from the snap, or as the public seems to be calling the return of the missing, the blip. May got popped into her home 5 years after she disappeared, into an apartment that had since been rented out to somebody else. Because, of course, life went on. Of course, there's a charity that's specifically dealing with the fallout of the blip, because suddenly, the population of the Earth redoubled, just as they were presumably getting settled with the new normal. This is the sort of thing that I was talking about earlier, where Endgame covered broad strokes, while Spider-Man does a better job of addressing the problems that the little people face in the aftermath. Like how Civil War addressed Age of Ultron and the separate Avengers other scuffles, but how the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. series does a better job of displaying the Sokovia Accords in practice. While, of course, the place they'd really shine, the Netflix series, omitted them entirely. A couple of last bits of minutiae before we start to wrap up. Visually, the film was stunning, especially the illusion sequences, zombie Iron Man and the flashy Spider-Verse-like shimmers being the standouts. Peter using his spider sense in those final scenes with Beck was absolutely beautiful. The range of suits being shown, including the nanobot case that the Iron Spider costume sits in, was great, and the scene of Peter making his hybrid suit, mirroring Tony making the Mark II with Back in Black playing, was nothing short of perfection. It nailed home the parallels between them and their similarities, and I loved it 3000. In fact, I suppose while we're on the subject, we do need to talk about negatives. There was no Morgan Stark in this film, which will be a complaint I have with every MCU film until that child reappears. Minus 1 point for the lack of adorable. There was no Vulture return or payoff from the Scorpion scene at the end of Homecoming, and there was no reference to Dimitri being the chameleon. I suppose a lot of those boil down to where is my Sinister Six at? There was also no Karen, with Edith essentially filling the role. We're not clear at this point whether Karen was an integral part of the Stark suit that was destroyed in this movie, or whether she's still part of the Iron Spider suit, or when Tony returned his suit at the end of Homecoming, he received it sans Karen. Also, while I fully appreciate not giving Peter his traditional origin story, because good God, we have been Thomas and Martha Wayne'd so many times that it's just paint by numbers at this point, it would be nice at some point to get something about Uncle Ben in the MCU, even just in passing. And also, Tom Hardy's Eddie Brock and Venom, I know is in the same legal no man's land as Tom Holland's contract, but I can just imagine the two of them playing off of each other so well, and if Sony knows what they're doing, they will insist that Venom be part of the MCU in exchange for releasing the rights to more Spider-Man films. And if Disney know what they're doing, they'll agree. There is one more thing coming, but I will get to that. Otherwise, that's about it, really, and the multiverse and the Hydro Man stuff I mentioned earlier, so yeah, everything I didn't like was stuff that wasn't in the film, rather than stuff that was. A+, A star, first class. It's a flipping stellar film and the best possible epilogue to Phase 3. And the whole of the MCU up to this point, it's been a wild 11 years, and here's to 11 more. Oh wait, we're not done yet. We still have the post-credit scenes to talk about, and boy did they carry more weight than any have in a long time. In fact, my final complaint about the film is that the two best scenes in the movie, bar the reveal of Beck as a bad guy, are the mid and post-credit scenes. And I don't know how much of a good look that is, despite how awesome the scenes themselves are. But anyway, our two scenes are: number one, Beck posthumously revealing Peter's identity to the world by way of an InfoWars-style Daily Bugle. And two, the reveal that Talos and his wife have been impersonating Nick Fury and Maria Hill for at least this entire movie. We could probably churn out an entire video on each of these alone, but I'll try and be as succinct as possible here. Wherever Spider-Man 3 goes, it is absolutely critical that Peter's unmasking not just be a minor plot point that gets sidestepped. This is huge. The core Avengers are gone, and with them a huge amount of the weight behind anything the team standing with Peter might have in declaring the video a fake. That said, Spider-Man's always had a bit of a cult following in the comics. Everyone either loves him or hates him, so maybe it's going that route. They could of course go the one more day route of erasing the events, but I don't see a big event negating thing happening outside of a Doctor Strange film or an ensemble film. Of course, he does know Doctor Strange, so there's very little he couldn't do to fix the problem. If Strange is willing or available, of course. Maybe we'll get Kraven going after him, maybe the MCU's version of the Sinister Six, or the Punisher. Maybe this is a chance to loop in the non-Netflix versions of the Netflix characters, although there we fall into the rights question again. Or a level of empathy with the newly arrived mutants for the unfair hatred they presumably get, on which note I really don't know how or why they're going to play mutants off as being not okay in the MCU when we've already got humans and enhanced people and aliens being public knowledge. Sorry, that's totally off topic, it just sprang into my head. It's important to note for the sake of completeness that we simply don't know when Spider-Man 3 will drop at this point. At the very late stage that I'm recording this last segment, we know the lineup for Phase 4, and a rough sketch of Phase 5 as well. What's oddly missing is Spider-Man 3. The reason for this is that Sony announces their own films, which Spidey technically is. So it could be a Phase 4 film. Maybe. But the reason for this aside is that whatever happens next for Spidey, based on the events of his identity being revealed, is massive. And it has to be based pretty soon after. So I'd like to hope that this scene is a way of the studio telling us it's coming sooner rather than later. The Talos scene, on the other hand, reopens the "Is Nick Fury a Skrull?" conversation that came up in the wake of Captain Marvel, and it definitely answers it. Vaguely. Yes, at some points in the series, Nick Fury may well have been a Skrull. Maybe when he cut his sandwich in Age of Ultron, he was a Skrull. Maybe when he was snapped. Maybe at Tony's funeral, when his death was faked in Winter Soldier. But more importantly, it leaves us with a space station-adjacent Nick Fury, who is almost certainly working on building up S.W.O.R.D. for the future space-focused Marvel stories to come. And it also somewhat adds to the possibility of Fury appearing in Captain Marvel 2 when it eventually comes. So, Spider-Man Far From Home. Pretty gosh darn good. Just a little bit better than Homecoming, which makes it, as I said, about my second favourite solo film and my fourth favourite overall MCU film. Adam likes.